Hey, you're watching the acid drip. So, I am going to do a small, like, personal life update. And then I'm going to jump into practicing. So real quick, some things that are going on. This week, I just completed my first 2 weeks as a substitute teacher. And I just want to do a quick shout out to Suba's seventh period class. You guys were awesome. And I had a lot of fun teaching you guys last week. And yeah, you know, it was just fun to talk with you guys and try and relate to you, you know. Anyway, trying to loosen up my fingers. I haven't practiced guitar in 2 days, which is kind of frustrating. I didn't practice. Today's Saturday. Didn't practice Friday or Thursday. And what I'm trying to do right now is prepare for a recording session. So not practicing is not a good thing. I have a recording session on September 29th. Today is the 1st. So I have 29 days to get my shit together and lock down some really tough songs. So I'm going to go ahead and open those songs up in Guitar Pro and talk about a few other things. So one of the things is I'm trying to also figure out what my plan will be for next year, because to be honest with you, this year is gonna be over with pretty fast. And I am doing a drawing class with Noah Buchanan, and I am working on this recording session. I'm working as a substitute teacher, and I'm also working on several art projects. If you've been following my YouTube channel, I've been posting pretty regularly updates on a project for Jeff Bodum and his band Aspen Way. But I'm also working on one of my personal projects, Clarity. It's up there. I have a copy of the rough draft template poster hanging from my ceiling. And every night before I go to bed, I look at it. So it's the last thing I see before I go to sleep. And every morning when I wake up, it's the first thing I see. And it kind of acts like a fulcrum, like a pivot point, where I know that, like, this project, Clarity, and the work that I'm doing for it is the reason why I'm here. Like, these kind of art projects, doing Clarity. I have Matriarch, which is in the pipeline. I have a mask drawing that's in the pipeline. I have an iceberg project that's in the pipeline, and a few others that are coming up. I have a horse and frog, but those ones I probably won't get to until next year. But I am trying to get Clarity, Jeff's project for sure, by the end of the month. Clarity, though, hopefully going closer to completion by the end of the year. And the mask by the end of the year, which would put me at 4 complete art projects between during 2018. I finished Wind Breath like very early in 2018. I think it was like January or something like that. I finished it, but it took a really long time to finish the setup for the business and the printing, and that really delayed me. So now I'm trying to get faster at my projects and produce more. And it's tough because I'm doing that while trying to do a day job, while trying to do like a lot of other stuff. It's not easy at all. It's actually like really, really difficult. So these are pretty much the songs that I'm working on. I'm going to just open up Redneck. I'm going to open up Redneck Loops as well, because I should work on the loops. And then I'm going to open up one last file. This is something I still have to do, is I have to go into here and I have to get Detox. That one is wrong. This one is right. Okay, so real quick, this is to explain my logic. if you look at the file name right here, this is 11th hour, 210 BPM, but this is the flat tempo version. So what I do is I first transcribe the song and I transcribe it exactly the way it was written. And then what I do is I go ahead and create loops. So this one right here, the loops are a little bit different, so I didn't really need to create loop files. But to give you an example of a project that did need loop files was Redneck. This song is like really tight on its groove. And so I basically picked the two pivot points in this song. So hang on, let me get into drop D. There are two really, really intense riffs in this song that you have to really like get down. And there's this whole thing called the suspension of disbelief, the idea that like what you're doing is defying reality, even though like what you're doing is very much real and grounded. It's kind of like a counterintuitive thing, but when you're really good at what you do, it creates an illusion. You make it look simple, right? That's because of the suspension of disbelief. You're doing something that looks really incredibly difficult to do, and you're making it look easy. That's what makes us love, you know, our heroes. They do something really, really difficult, and they make it seem easy, and we sit there and say, wow, that guy's amazing. And the suspension of disbelief is like we see something happen that we can't believe, and yet it's happening in front of us. In writing, that's creating a world that might be fictitious, like in Harry Potter, the fictitious wizarding world. We all know that there's no such thing as wizards. Or in The Matrix, the fact that like the computer reality is super intricate. Hang on a second. Hello? So the suspension of disbelief is really important because what it does is it immerses people in the reality that you're creating. Again, in Harry Potter, there's no such thing as invisible wizarding Diagon Alley worlds. But we believe that it's real when we see the movie, read the books, or go to the amusement park. And we think the same thing about The Matrix, this invisible computer world, and it's because it's thoroughly constructed and every little detail is attended to. That's the concept in writing, and in music it also exists, and in art it also exists. In music, it's the transition. The transition is what creates the suspension of disbelief. So in order to do the part properly, you have to isolate things in loops, which is what this is. This is taking a part that needs to be isolated, and it's setting it aside. So here's one of the loops, and here is the other loops. Just scrolled past it. So these are basically the breakdown riffs. The da 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 da. That's this second bar right here. You'll hear that in just a second. So that loop right there is really important. That's like a really good character, like a really well-written character. But that character, not in context of the rest of the world, the greater Harry Potter world, is just a floating character with no world to ground it. And so each, I consider a loop a character, and the song is the world that the character lives within. You isolate the character or that individual loop and you master it. That's what this is. This is like me just sitting down and doing this one part until I have it down. And then what I try and do is just do this part at tempo, like as much as I can. Like this song is supposed to be at 130, I'm at 100. So then once I get it to 130, probably should be pushing it to about 140, a little bit faster than tempo. You want to be able to do it faster than tempo in isolation. Like, you want to be able to do the song faster in isolation, the loop faster in isolation than the actual song is, because you are going to slow down when you actually play the song itself. And I've kind of like arrived at this process of like isolating and then inserting, where I find a loop that's really difficult. I isolate it like I did here, and then I insert it back into the song by creating a flat tempo version. So in 11th hour, it is at 210 BPM, but there are certain points where it slows down and then speeds up. So the fastest tempo that this song plays, though, at the highest tempo, is at 210 BPM, which means if I can play every single part of 11th hour at 210 BPM without a question of doubt, that means that any of the slower parts I will also be able to play in tempo because they're slower, so it should be easier. And the way you get clean playing out of it is you start below tempo. So like, there are certain sections in this song that are, I think, at 160. So if I start this at 135, like I am right now, I'll probably start at 120 actually and then go back up to 135. Eventually I will pass through 160. I'll go 120, 135, 160, 175, 180, and then 195, and then 210. And that's probably where I'll max out at. Maybe like I'll try and maybe push it at 225 to see if I can go above tempo. Not because like I want to play faster than the song, it's that I want to push myself to feel comfortable at that pace so that when I play it slower, it's even more in the pocket. By doing it this way, building up from a slow tempo up, when I have to actually play the real version of the song, it'll feel easier. This is actually harder than playing the song, doing it this way. But when I actually play the song the way it was recorded, I'll be able to just lock into it. So, like I said, I got a recording session on the 29th. My goal is to do 11th Hour, Ruin, Black Label, and Redneck. And then I've got like a bonus goal, which is Detox. And this version of Detox, this is what I'm talking about. This is at 165 BPM, going back to the whole concept of flat tempo. But if I scroll down, there's a certain point where it slows down to 134, and that's kind of trippy. And then it goes above that. It goes way above that. Hang on. It goes back up to 165. And this part right here is really freaking hard to do at 165. I'll play this part for you. Yeah, that's really hard to do. And then this walk down. That's also really hard to do. So this really needs to be practiced at a flat tempo, and it needs to be started like way lower than 165 and then brought up to 165. So I'm going to create a flat tempo version of this, and then work on that. So Detox is an additional goal, and then I have one original song that I'm going to try and record, which is this thing right here, this Chris and Keenan riff. And this thing was really hard to write. This was like really hard to write. I have a small video stream where I started writing this while recording, but I had some problems with the recorder, but I'll be posting that very soon. So it's using a finger picking pattern, and it goes from 4-4 to 5-4, which is like 9-4, to 4-4 to 6-4, which is like 10-4, which is really 5-4. And it does weird stuff. I'm thinking about finding a way to like make it just 4-4, 6-4, and just get rid of that weird 5-4 bar and just make everything, you know, in the same time. I need to simplify this song. Like, a lot of the other songs are difficult, but there's a simplicity to them. And like, yeah, see, there's a bar of 6-4 and then it goes back to weird 5-4. So there's not really a lot of structure. It's like an A, B, A, C pattern where the A bar is always going to be in 4-4 and then the B bar is 5-4 and then the C bar is 6-4, which is kind of weird. And I want to try and simplify it. And then starting from here, this whole section's in 4-4. And there's just a huge section that's in straight 4-4. And then it goes into a weird 5-4 and then back into 4-4. This 5-4 at the end is cool because it kind of lets you know, like, hey, that section's ending and we're about to repeat. And it kind of is like a gut check to see if you're paying attention. And then the song ends on the 5-4, sustaining into a regular 4-4, which... I don't know. I could probably make this time instead of 4-4-3-4 and just make it fit like it's an 8. In fact, I might just do that. And then now it's an 8. So now this is really just two bars of 4-4. And that's kind of the end of it. But yeah, that's kind of what I created. And yeah, it's pretty difficult. I'm not very good at finger picking. I decided to write this because I wanted to write something very different. And I'm going into the recording session doing a bunch of heavy metal shit. Like, I'm doing probably 4 Lamb of God songs, potentially 1 Strapping Young Lad song, and then this thing. And I have to record 6 songs in about 5 hours. So... if I have my shit together, I should be able to do each one of these songs on like the second or third try. Each song is like 5 minutes. So like 15 minutes a song times 5 is like maybe an hour and a half, maybe 2 hours tops. And I have 5 hours to do this. Like, I have plenty of time in the studio to do this shit. And like, you know, maybe do like a few little overdub parts. Like, it really is reasonable to record these songs in that period of time. It shouldn't be hard to record. What should be hard is this fucking rehearsal. So yeah, I guess that's enough of the talking, and now I'm gonna begin the streaming. So I guess this is day 1 of 29. I have 29 days to get 6 things under my belt. If I have to cut something off, I don't know what I would cut off, but I really think these 6 things, if I stay focused on them, will get me through the day. I'm pretty close to having Redneck down. I'm pretty close to having Ruin down. I'm working on 11th Hour. I'm pretty close to Black Label. I have not looked at Detox in a long time. If I have to cut a song, it'll probably be Detox. And I don't know this song I wrote. I really don't know it. I wrote it and I don't know it. I have to really work on the transitions. I've been isolating certain parts of it, but I really have to like sit down and grind on it. We'll see how it goes. I got 29 days. So yeah, I guess that's it for this recording. And I am just gonna pause this real quick and then get started on the next thing. See you guys in a second.